Good morning, students. This is Professor Mike Lilly. The class is called Terrorism. This is lecture number 19 this semester. And two things. One, I've not finished your old test. I am just about done. I'll have it finished later this afternoon. For those who missed the test, as those persons who normally show up in the class to take the test, we will make arrangements for you to take that test after the end of today's class. Finally, I guess good news or bad news, depending on which you prefer. Yours truly will not be on campus coming Thursday or Friday. I'm an annual conference up in Morgantown. So this class will not physically meet Thursday, nor will the class after. There will be, as far as I know, a catch-up lecture which will be posted a bit later, maybe tomorrow, if I can find time to do it. We'll see how that goes. Other than that, however, I have a conference on international studies, and it always has lots of information which I can use to pick up in this class and other classes. Let me do something I normally don't do, and that is I want to backtrack some on some of our lectures because I want to follow up on discussions we've had about the enmity between Saudi Arabia and Turkey. And that's because, and I'm honest, I rarely do things, but this is a Wall Street Journal from last week discussing this. So let me read a quote from it, and this kind of will probably tell you a little better about why these two nations have been so historically mad at each other. Two centuries ago, in the fall of 1818, a Saudi monarch named Saud was brought to Istanbul in chains by a conquering army of the Ottoman Empire. He was displayed in a cage that hung from the ceiling to cheering crowds outside the Hagia Sophia Mosque. And then, among celebratory fireworks, his head was chopped off for crowd's pleasure. This gruesome episode in the shared history of Turkey and Saudi Arabia hasn't been mentioned in public as the two countries have clashed over the October 2nd killing of the Saudi journalist Khashoggi in the embassy. But it certainly does tell us more about this lengthy history between why there is such, again, always rivalry between these two Muslim nations in the Middle East. Basically speaking, this is the third. The current kingdom of Saudi Arabia is the third time that Saudi princes have come up with third time that the Saudi the House of Saud has tried to establish a kingdom in Arabia under their leadership. The Sauds, again, initially a Bedouin tribe that revolted against the Ottomans in 1817, I think it is. The Ottoman Empire then still being ruled again by the its ruler, Sultan. And by the way, the last Sultan, or the last king, if you will, of the Ottoman Empire, ruled until he was officially deposed and sent into exile in 1924. There's actually a picture of him here riding his horse-drawn carriage in the streets of Istanbul right before his being forced into exile. Now, I mention this only because, not because of the gruesome nature of the story, although sometimes I know I delight in that, but in this case, simply to show you again that the current fight between Turkey and Saudi Arabia is at least 200 years old, perhaps older than that. Now, we want to change lanes here. I'm not the next. Yes, eight or so classes that we have left this semester yet. That's about all we've got. Are going to be devoted to the question of domestic terrorism. So I want to start that off with a few things that I hadn't talked about or emphasized in the first chapter in your text, where it talks about what is terrorism and how do you define it, etc. Currently, United States law says that terrorism is an act of violence in support of a political philosophy or objective. We currently are in the throes, quite bluntly, of two what I consider terrorist acts that are taking place and are still happening here in this country. The first of which, this madman down in Florida, who converted his van into a bomb mart making factory. He drove around in secret making pipe bombs, which is then, we now know, has been mailed to at least 14 people. But they just discovered two more yesterday, in addition to the original 12. And there may be more. We don't know about that as yet to show up in the postal system, although I suspect most part. You see, the interesting thing about it is that he isn't being charged with terrorism. Why? Because he wasn't really espousing any political cause. The same is true with this other madman, the anti-Semitic racist, up in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, who just massacred for no reason other than his anti-Semitic hatred of all people who are Jewish. He's not charged with terrorism. Instead, he's charged with a hate crime. My problem is that I think this definition, it seems to imply that the only people who do terrorist acts in this country have to be on behalf of some foreign group or whatever, woefully inadequate. That's because we here in the United States have a long and unfortunate, usually hidden history that most people are unaware of terrorism on the domestic branch. By domestic terrorism, I'm basically speaking of groups that tend to use violence, threats of violence, whatever, because of their desire to overthrow the United States government and replace it with whatever their current ideology says. We've had terrorists, domestic terrorists on both the left and right, principally on the right, but not necessarily also. So let me try to explain what I'm talking about here. Probably the first real terrorist group here in this country came into being before we were a separate country. And it was a group of young radicals in and around Boston and Philadelphia called the Sons of Liberty. Sons of Liberty. Now that, by the way, is a term that several of your current right-wing extremist groups have tried to pin on themselves, but the Sons of Liberty was basically a organization aimed at trying at promoting revolt against the British authority. Their most famous act, the so-called Boston Tea Party. When groups of, again, mostly young people, dressed up like Native Americans and boarded a British merchant ship, throw its cargo over into the ocean, I guess making the largest batch of iced tea we've ever seen. This was called an act of political courage and is bragged about even today, the Boston Tea Party. Well, it was a terrorist act because at the time, again, this was a merchant ship doing legitimate business, importing tea here into the United States. And the only reason that they objected to it back in 1763 was because the English had imposed a tax on most foreign goods coming into the United States called the Stamp Act. The Sons of Liberty would pop up more than once during the events leading up to the Revolutionary War. And we certainly know that during the war, they perpetrated a number of acts, political and otherwise, against supporters of the British Crown in the War for Independence. One of their particular things was stirring up crowds to tar and feather. They called Tories, which were basically British loyalists during the Revolution. Now the other side, that is the supporters of the Crown, I guess had their own groups, but they actually fielded, of course, a fairly significant fighting force here in the United States to support King George III and also to put down this rebellion against government authority. Particularly in the South and in North Carolina and other places, these groups of British sympathizers would go around one particular town was burned to the ground in northern North Carolina. They like to burn churches, farms, houses, etc., would be rebel supporters. Indeed, their actions were so vicious as to spark what would come to be probably what I think is the most significant turning point in the Revolutionary War, the Battle of Kings Mountain. occurs in North Carolina. Oh, if y'all have ever been to the Battle of Kings Mountain or heard of it. Well, the leader of the Tory Army in Carolina was closely associated with Lord Cornwallis, who at that time was conducting a campaign in the Carolinas with a fairly large British army to put down Resurrection himself. This Tory leader issued a challenge in which he told American sympathizers here in the Virginias and in it's now Tennessee that if they did not put down their arms and support the crown, that he would burn all of their homes and kill all of their families, including this threat would cause, to be honest, the normal individualist settlers in our own area to suddenly decide that they didn't like this threat. And thus it is that a group of people from what is now Tazewell County, Virginia, and around the town of Tazewell and others, would get up their rifles and muskets and would march down to Abington, Virginia. No, not Abington. Basically around Johnson City or Bristol area, where they met up with a number of other colonists, forming an army of about 1,000, so-called Over the Mountain Boys, because basically they trudged on horseback all the way down to northern North Carolina, Kings Mountain, which is east of closer to Charlotte. The Battle of Kings Mountain is instrumental in the American War for Independence because these Over the Mountain Boys, again, homestead settlers living in log cabins, etc., mostly in homesteads, had become so incensed that they fought and utterly defeated and actually partially massacred Tory forces. The end of that fight basically meant that Cornwallis was forced into a retreat, in which he is then formally defeated at the Battle of Falcons, and then leaves the Carolinas to go up to Yorktown, where he meets Washington and French troops. I know this is ancient American history, but Battle of Kings Mountain would not have happened had it not been for the terrorist-type Reagan raids that the Tory forces were doing to American households. Yeah, there's a fictional account of all of this, very fictional, because it confuses most of the real-life things of American history in Mel Gibson's movie, The Patriot. Patriot doesn't include the Battle of Kings Mountain, which is the most important, which is that key turning point. And that's right, the leaders in the fight from our area, that's where they headed up and got on their horses and rode to battle. Again, this large army moving over 800 miles on foot and horseback only, with no trails of paths, a mount of feet for horses. But that's for another day before that. If the Sons of Liberty is the first terrorist organization we've had, there certainly have been others, but probably the most infamous and notorious that we know of course, is the Ku Klux Klan. I mentioned the Ku Klux Klan because certainly it continues to get lots of press even though essentially the Klan as an organized movement is pretty much extinct. No, I didn't say there weren't offshoot Klan groups in some places, but basically, Klan is not what it once was. I think it's hard for us to understand exactly all of the Klan's influence, but let me try to basically start. The Klan itself is formed at the end of the Civil War by former Confederate General Nathan Bedford Forrest, one of the most inventive of all of the Confederate generals. Famous phrasing was to get there the fastest with the mostest. Forrest set this secret organization up basically on the supposed grounds of protecting former Confederate sympathizers from attacks that were being imagined upon them by the newly freed slaves, and also by the, of course, the Federal Army, which, as you know, stayed in the South for about 12 years after the end of the Civil War. That's Reconstruction. The Klan, however, although it had a supposedly legitimate purpose, soon descended basically into a racist terrorist organization. Thus it is that its founder, General Forrest, could disavow the Klan and would leave it shortly, within about 3 years or so after it then. And that's because he recognized what it had become. It was basically a group of individuals who, in order to remain anonymous, so they could carry out their acts of intimidation, put white sheets on top of them as robes, and then put large pointed white hats on their heads, basically eye holes cut in them so you could see their faces. And among the things they did was spurred lynchings in the South. They liked to burn crosses, burn up black families to intimidate them, and other things. All the marks of a classic terrorist organization. No, they didn't have suicide bombers, and no, they didn't have mostly large massacres of their opponents. But Klan remained an important force here in the United States, political force, for many, many years. In the 1920s, at the end of World War II, Klan had a major revival in this country. And it had a lot of influence, not just southern states, but had much more influence in states you wouldn't think of as being southern. Oklahoma and Indiana being the two key states we speak of. In Indiana, you had a member of the Klan elected as governor, and the entire legislature basically ruled by the Klan in 1927. Yeah, I said Indiana. I didn't say Mississippi or Alabama or Georgia. Okay? The deadliest race riot in American history occurs not in the Deep South, but in Oklahoma. When based on mythical false charges, Klan stirred up race mob descends upon an all-black community in southern Oklahoma and burns it to the ground, killing hundreds of people in the process. In fact, it was only recently through some archaeological excavations in that area that we know how many people actually may have died in that racist assault. And well, I can't think of the name of the town. I know lecture. And this was in 1912, I want to say. In the 20th century. And again, in this particular case, we have, it's an all-black community there in Oklahoma. Peaceful, loving people. I mean, there was no reason for them. And suddenly we have people from all over descending on the town, attacking it, raping women, killing men, children, I guess, burning the entire town. The community has never been resurrected since. So, when I speak, therefore, of the Klan, I am speaking of the Klan as what it is, a terrorist organization aimed at, one, preventing the American federal government from intervening into the South, and two, more specifically, making sure that blacks were kept in their place, as they like to say. In other words, that rights of the African Americans in the South and wherever the Klan ruled, I would not take place. I'm not quite sure of the year, but I will make, and I have to start looking at my figures more. I believe it's in 1924. We have a mammoth Klan rally in Washington, D.C., where over 40,000 robed, hooded Klansmen marched on the Washington Mall to the cheers of the press. Yeah, a large, large group openly. Openly showing their symbols. So to say that the Klan did not have significant influence, particularly 20s and during the Depression, is a false one. The fall of the Klan really occurs as we enter World War II, and there's no reasons for that. One is that as a result of the war effort, large numbers of blacks would be put into the military and to their armed forces. And when they returned from the war, they weren't so easily intimidated as their forebears. Second, American culture and traditions changes in that we certainly realize that all Americans have rights, not just some of us. Although that remains, I think, a major problem and issue today. Now, the Klan itself kind of falls into disuse again after the end of the World War II. It has a revival in the late 50s and early 60s as the civil rights movement takes place in the South. We certainly know the Klan was active in its terrorist activities, including, of course, its one of those more modern infamous actions, right? The murder of the four freedom riders who were kidnapped at gunpoint from their car by a sheriff and his clan buddies, and then murdered and buried in graves. Their murder would shock the nation, and it's interesting that it was disclosed as a result of the FBI's infiltration of the Klan and finding out who they were. The Klan, we know, did other acts, including, of course, the burning of the church in Mississippi where four young girls were killed. It is only in the last 8 or 9 years that the Klansmen who burned that church to the ground and killed those young girls brought to justice. So the Klan has been active, but it is, and it may be stirring again, but I think it's now been replaced by other hate groups here in the United States, right-wing hate groups. To say again that the Klan is, I don't know, will it always be with us? Let's hope not. Let's hope not. But again, I can't necessarily say that's true. Anyway, I still think most people, to be really honest, ignorant of the influence that the Klan has had here in this country for so long as it did. Remember again that Klan inspired terrorist acts and also acts of other Southern races, particularly during the early part of the 20th century, meant that well over 500 people would be lynched or in reality murdered by race mobs, most of them, because of alleged criminal attacks on white people, particularly claims of rape against white women or killing of white individuals. It's surprising how many of those cases had no real bearing in reality. You know, in criminal procedure, we talk about the case of Brown versus Mississippi, which is a typical Ku Klux Klan racist event, which three black men are basically tortured by being, one, hung from a tree by a hangman's noose, and then beaten with a whip as they were tied to the tree, until they confessed over a 3 or 4 day period. And then on the basis of these so-called voluntary confessions are given the death sentence. Well, the Supreme Court, that was too much even for one of the most conservative Supreme Courts of the time, who in that case of Brown versus Mississippi again, basically throw their conviction out saying we don't allow torture and rack, medieval type torture to rule in this country. An opinion at the time loudly complained out by Southern legislatures. They said, oh, wait a minute, the state of Mississippi Supreme Court said this was a voluntary confession, and, you know, we don't like you Yankees from deciding otherwise, even though one of the authors of the opinion was a Southern. So, yeah, I mean, that's, again, I always talk about that case because it talks about, again, this issue of domestic terrorism in the South. We don't have lynchings anymore. If nothing else at the end of most of the Klan's influence and the civil rights movement has done is it ended this reign of terror which really took place prior to 1940 in this country. Uh, some ways we've come a long way, and in some ways we have not come a long way, as far as this issue. But we certainly no longer have mobs who form on hearing again of an alleged myth, taking someone out and hanging, burning their bodies in public, etc. Many of the lynchings that took place are certainly worse than the fate of King Saul at the hands of Alvin Turks. And I particularly like to think of Emmett Till, a young 14-year-old boy accused of whistling at a white woman, although there's some disputes whether it happened. Emmett Till being kidnapped, tortured, horribly disfigured before he finally died by a Klansman. His face so horribly disfigured that his corpse could not be shown to the public. Although his mother then insisted it was shown so that the country would see just the horror that had taken place to her young son. It took a long time for the murderers of Emmett Till to ever be truly exposed and punished. There have been some, but once again, that's probably the last, what I would call real lynching, I guess. But Emmett Till's murder, once again, galvanized the civil rights movement and turned lots of people in this country finally against this form of terrorism as it existed here. Now, in the World War II, March Hauer, another form of events that began to take place here in the United States. And that is the creation of a new ideology to replace the racism of the Klan. And this new ideology is, it's with us very much today. And it has to do with a number of things and events. I guess I should comment some on them. Prior to World War II breaking out, there was a lot of sympathy here in the United States for the Nazi regime in Germany. Now today, that sounds unbelievable. There's an organization centered in New York City called the German Bund, BND, which was a group of open Nazi German sympathizers, which had a significant political force at the time and drew thousands of people to its annual meetings. German Bund would be dissolved when Adolf Hitler declares war on the United States after Pearl Harbor. But it showed principally in its violent anti-Semitism and speeches made at their group meetings, again blaming Jews in America for all sorts of problems and issues. I think former members of the Bund, and I have to say it's my belief, are those who have created one of the most incredible myths of our time, and that is that the Holocaust never happened. That all the pictures we have were faked, right? That it was propaganda against the Nazi regime, that only a few people may have died in German concentration camps, claim the Germans never used slave labor was difficult. Millions of people enslaved doing their work for them. So when you hear someone like, Jones saying that Holocaust never happened, and others in the far right movements of today saying that, they all harken back again to pro-Nazi sympathizers prior to World War II. Now, these Nazi sympathizers, again, were one of the reasons why German military believed that they could send saboteurs here into the United States to support these saboteurs. And of course, as you may or may not know, there was one particular group of about four or five of them who were put ashore in Kitty Hawk, North Carolina, or in that vicinity, by a German U-boat, and whose job was to infiltrate the United States and do saboteuring work and intelligence work for the Germans. They were German citizens who spoke American English. They were all captured within a short period of time. But of course, there's always this humor in doubt, were there other German sympathizers who may have come in from Canada or other places, right? Come into our country from South America. Because, of course, the significant sympathies for the German regime, particularly in Argentina, but also in Brazil. Which, I have to be honest, one of the reasons that I always liked Philip K. Dick's novel, The Man in the High Castle, which is now a television show, now its third season. Philip Dick at that time, imagining North America in which it is evenly divided, or not evenly divided, but divided between Nazi Germany and militaristic Japan. I'm not necessarily recommending the show because not everybody, a lot of people like it, but it shows what would have happened, I think. It's occurred. I like it. I always have, but then I first read the novel in the early 60s. Yeah. I mean, that's not the only alternate history of German winning. There's several others. Fatherland is another one. Not that the U.S. is ruled, but. And also, his name, Toporov, has a book in which basically he has Charles Lindbergh elected as president when he almost ran against FDR. Charles Lindbergh was a noted German sympathizer, flew to Germany and hobnobbed with all, you know, with Goering and lots of other Nazi royalty because of their aircraft. In the war itself, he would turn against those sympathies. But the novel by Philip Roth, again, it's a fictional thing of what would happen if Lindbergh had been elected and forces like the German Bund had become ascendant and followed its racist policies here in the United States. And why am I reminded of all of this? It's again, this anti-Semitic attack on a synagogue.
Researcher, if you want Hitler and Nazi printing, I know just about everything that happened in the fight, drug, local, or whatever. I talk about that all day long. They say history repeats itself. I'm starting to see it happening.
Well, history does repeat itself. not necessarily exactly the same, but so. And to say that anti-Semitism has been with us for a long time, I might add, by the way, it's very much, in a lot of ways, institutionalized here in this country. You might be surprised where all it used to pop up and show up. I'm not really necessarily here to discuss all of that, but simply to understand that even with all of these pro-German sympathizers here in the United States, we still never had any mass shootings or attacks leading up to World War II, which I've already, and that's kind of somewhat amazing. But in the last 2 years, we have seen open anti-Semitic statements. Now, again, let's talk about this new ideology I want to mention. An ideology based on lots of strange misconceptions. But I might then mention, since I'm talking about anti-Semitism, there is an anti-Semitic fabrication known as the Protocols of Zion, which supposedly Jewish leaders created a secret cabal to take over the world. The Protocols of Zion has been used for over 300 years as something to attack Jewish interests with, particularly England and here in the United States. And I know Hitler read it, so again, this idea and this concept that there's some sort of secret organization, right, dedicated to overthrowing, ruling the world. Likewise, again, I'm not really sure exactly how this all comes into play, but for a long time, anti-Semitism in this country really knocked off its feet by the revelations of the Holocaust. I well remember talking with an old friend of mine, Max Cameron, who started Cameron Furniture here in Tucson. Max Cameron was on the general staff of George Patton, major, as I recall, in the war, planning in Patton's march for Germany, and was also present at the liberation of Dachau, I believe, one of the more notorious death camps that the Germans had. Max Cameron, of course, is Jewish. He used to talk to me, it's kind of hard for some to get it out, but he would talk about the horror he saw when he and Americans liberated that camp and how they wanted to murder and massacre every German SS person there at that camp at the time and had to be physically prevented from doing it. The horror of the Holocaust and what happened after the Holocaust did lots of things. It really created the modern state of Israel by these hundreds of thousands of Holocaust survivors as they flee to Israel, right? Because they want a safe place to live. Rather, they're afraid if they stay in Europe, there are going to be more death camps set up. The British attempting to keep them from going and only failing. But it also meant here in the United States, as we see those horrors shown, and as our anti-Nazi understandings come into play, in a sense, seems to climb. Now, at the same time, we're not worried about the Protocols of Zion anymore. Now we're worried about something else. and that is a war and its beginnings and the threat of communism. Now, we in the United States have had three what I call red scares. The first red scare is in 1917-1918, when as the Bolsheviks are appearing to be winning after the collapse of Tsarist Russia, there is this strange belief that communist Bolshevik forces are going to take over the United States government as a result of socialism. And indeed, as you probably may or may not remember, U.S. troops actually were embarked at Vladivostok, Russia, military unit to oppose the Bolshevik forces, supporting what was called the White Russians, which was the remnants of the short-lived Russian democracy after the end of the war. Russian Revolution. So we had this fear, which is why in 1920 we have the law passed making it a crime to fly a red flag in the U.S. Flag meaning all red, because that was a symbol of communism. The second great red hysteria takes place beginning in 1947-48, when it becomes more than obvious that Stalin and his armies are intent on seizing as much of Europe as they can to control them as colonial territories. And so we have almost all of Eastern Europe, including half of Germany, being seized and ruled by basically Russian military forces. It is in 1948 that Harry Truman declares, that Winston Churchill talks about the Iron Curtain descending on Europe and marks the true beginning of the Cold War. 49, the Russians through spies have obtained secrets to make the atomic bomb. They set their first bomb off in 1949. And we have this fear arising in this country that perhaps Stalin's agents aren't just aimed at Eastern Europe, maybe here in the United States. You know, through labor unions and other socialist-leaning organizations. Now, we had, by the way, prior to World War II, an active American Communist Party, which is its name. It certainly was mainly centered in New York City, but it was in other places. And there was this fear that through this group, that we had indoctrinated communist agents trying to take over much of the government. Which is why, again, I set up the Council on American Activities Commission and Congress, Senate version of it also, to ferret out would-be communists. Claims being made, particularly by Joe McCarthy and others, right, that the American government was riddled with evil communist sympathizers, all aimed at one thing, a socialist revolution here in the United States to overthrow our government. Now, McCarthy, particularly beginning in 52, again has his campaign in which he claims to have hundreds, maybe thousands of people in the State Department and other places, again, are all communist sympathizers. He certainly puts out the so-called blacklist of individuals who are communist associates or known communists in Hollywood, actors, actresses, directors, etc., all being put on this list, and therefore lives pretty much ruined. And the Hollywood blacklist simply being a sign again of this wave coming across the country again. We were in danger of being taken over and overthrown by Soviet communist infiltrators. The fall of McCarthy, basically, became such a horrible force in this country. Finally, losing his political influence basically meant that the influence of anti-communist forces in this country starts to wane, but it never really ends. I recall being in graduate school myself, there was a group called Young Americans for Freedom, who principally were involved, among other things, would help promote Barry Goldwater in his presidential campaign. But Young Americans for Freedom published newsletters, and they were still talking about communist sympathizers. This is in 64, 65, communist sympathizers in the American government. So it's laid low. But for some strange reason, we have a confluence of communism and Judaism being linked together, along with anti-Christians. When I got out of law school long, long ago, there was a fellow here in town. His name was Sam Bailey. Sam basically had some severe mental problems. Supported, couldn't really work. He was supported by his family. Sam would write these lengthy treatises in which he blamed communist Jews, Rothschilds, industrialists, as being in some hidden group to overthrow the country. Now, who are the Rothschilds? Well, that's the banking industry set up. Reason I think in the Netherlands during the Middle Ages, because at this time the Catholic Church's position was that lending money from interest was a crime, not a crime for one of seven deadly sins. So therefore, most of your early banking systems on a national or international level were not created by Christians. By Jewish interest, because they could lend money for interest. Anyway, I always remember Sam Bailey's treatises. Fortunately, I don't have any more of them. But as a true crackpot view of things happening in this country, and it's only later I realized that these same basic views were being taken up elsewhere. And thus it is, in the closing minutes of today's lecture, I'm going to mention the publication of what remains today a pivotal work of the far right extremists, the so-called Turner Diary. No, we do not have a copy of the Turner Diaries here on campus, and if we did, I would seek to have it banned. Yes, I read some of it, but I couldn't even get through it. Anyway. and is extremely anti-racist, anti-everything else. But the Turner Diary is supposedly the history biography told through diary entries, the individual involved in a right-wing takeover of the United States. Okay? And the author of the Turner Diaries, named Franklin Pierce. That's not the name of the book. Franklin Pierce from Pocahontas County, West Virginia. We'll take more of on these, the next lecture I have. I presume I'm going to get to have that lecture online. You won't see it live because I'm not going to be here Thursday. With that in mind, I close for the day. And we'll take more up next week, most likely.